Hello, today I want to talk to you about the peripheral retina, an often overlooked area of the eye examination. It goes without saying that the retina is a vital element in the function of seeing, and yet traditionally during an eye examination it is one of the structures within the eye where great areas of it are, especially in patients who present with no symptoms, largely ignored. This is especially so with regard to NHS patients, where there is no funding paid within the basic NHS test to carry out a dilated fundus examination, except for certain categories of patients within the region of NHS Scotland. When we look at the sight testing regulations of 1989, there's not much help there. As we see, the regulation on inspecting the health of the eyes is very vague and woolly. Whilst establishing the need to look inside the eye to check for disease or abnormality, no mention is made as to how much of the retina should be inspected before arriving at a clinical decision. Should it be 5%, 25%, 65% or even 85%, or maybe 100%? There is no accepted limit. It's fair to say that on many occasions an optometrist inspection of a patient's retina is akin to a dental surgeon looking at the two front teeth of a patient and then making the assumption that if they're healthy, the rest probably are too. Now, I'm sure that if your dentist did that to you, you would be unhappy, and therefore we have to ask whether the approach we adopt to examining the retina is actually the right approach for our patients. Let me say that from the outset, many optometrists most probably still rely on their results from direct ophthalmoscopy as their sole means of examining the health of the retina. Indeed, many would argue that this is the peer view, and so should be accepted as us. I would also say that no advanced technique should be used within the remit of an NHS sight test without an appropriate increase in the NHS fee. However, the patient does have certain rights when visiting a primary care clinician, and one of these rights is to expect a full explanation of the tests carried out. Therefore, far from decrying direct ophthalmoscopy, I see the technique as acceptable so long as the patient is told of the basis on which the clinician is making their clinical judgment. In other words, the patient should be told that the clinician has looked at X percent of the retina, and based on that view and the patient's description of any symptoms, the clinical outcome is whatever it is. That way, the patient knows the basis for the judgment and the limitations to that clinical decision. That being said, we now have to consider whether the periphery of the retina warrants any attention or not. Many people nowadays buy expensive equipment that's capable of viewing the central part of the retina, but not the periphery. I've heard this justified on more than one occasion by the comment that the periphery of the retina is not important, as very rarely anything sight-threatening ever happens out there. That may be one argument, but I've seen too many macular off-retinal detachments that could have been avoided if the retinal tear had been spotted before it became a problem. The purpose of this talk is to look at what is actually out there in the periphery and to consider its importance to a patient's visual welfare. The periphery of the retina may not be directly involved in the process of everyday seeing, but like the anchor on a yacht, it plays a vital role in ensuring the part remains in place and capable of functioning. You don't need the anchor during the act of sailing, but when it comes to mooring up at night, no anchor and the boat drifts off to who knows where. So, the periphery of the retina doesn't really have a definite start point, but it's generally accepted it begins roughly 3 millimeters posterior to the equator of the eye, in the region of the vortex veins, and extends forwards to the oris serrata, where the retina terminates. I would like to consider the various types of retinal changes that can occur in this region and look at their predisposition to more serious retinal conditions. Lattice degeneration is the most common of all vitreoretinal degenerations and carries with it a high risk of retinal detachment. Approximately 6 to 8% of the general population will exhibit lattice degeneration. It is more common in myopes, with as many as 20 to 30% needing repair for retinal detachment at some stage. In 50% of cases, the condition is bilateral and is often associated with conditions such as Marfan's, Stickler, or Ehlers-Danlos syndrome. This makes detecting lattice degeneration highly important in asymptomatic patients, as they will need advice on what to look for should retinal detachment occur, and how to react to this, as well as advice on sensible lifestyle choices. May I suggest people with lattice degeneration may well be advised not to take up bungee jumping. Anecdotally, it's due to lattice degeneration and the resultant effects in the retinas of his son that Doug Anderson of Optos pioneered the Optom ultra-wide retinal imaging system. This is a system for viewing up to 200 degrees of retina with no dilation through pupils as small as 2 millimeters. A lot of the images shown in this presentation will be using this system. Lattice degeneration shows us sharply defined spindle-shaped areas of thinned retina, situated around the circumference of the retina between the equator and the vitreous base. They're commonly found in the supratemporal region of the retina and are actually discontinuations of the internal limiting membrane with varying amounts of atrophy of the underlying sensory retina. These slides show lattice degeneration with the classic spindle-like islands of retinal thinning, with a network or lattice of white lines within those islands. It is common to see different types of retinal pigment epithelial degeneration associated with lattice, and small round holes within the retina are common. This slide shows the typical course of events that will result in a retinal tear of varying proportions, and then more than likely onto a regmatogenous retinal detachment. You take a few minutes just to look at that. Snail tract degeneration gets its name because characteristically it looks like the slime trail left on a paving slab in the garden by a snail. This consists of sharply defined packs of closely arranged snowflakes. Snail tracts are well defined and tend to be smaller than areas of lattice degeneration. This slide shows an area of snail tracking in the lower temporal region, and the same in the other eye. They're not commonly associated with retinal tears due to vitreous traction, but they may be associated with large round holes. Retinal tufts can come in different types, and they can either be zonular retinal traction tufts, which occur in the vitreous base, with zonular fibers attached to the apex of the tuft. These usually occur singly, are congenital, and show an increased number in young patients. Common sites for their appearance are in the inferior and nasal periphery. They are a significant cause of retinal holes in the periphery. These holes are normally not of consequence, but in aphakic patients and some pseudophakes or other conditions where the zonular fibers may be subject to traction, these holes may be the cause of retinal detachment. The other type of tuft is the cystic retinal traction tuft. These are small projections of retinal tissue into the vitreous cavity. They're thought to be congenital. Retinal degeneration occurs at the base of the tufts, and severe vitreous traction can cause cystic tufts, which can lead to retinal detachment. And we see here a diagram of a cystic tuft out in the periphery. Degenerative retinoschisis is often said to be effectively dormant and doesn't cause problems, but this is not the case. Retinoschisis is found in 5% of the general population over 20. It is most common in hyperopic eyes, which account for 70% of this appearance. They are asymptomatic and bilateral in 60 to 70% of cases. They invariably start in the infratemporal quadrant and spread around the eye. Retinal detachment will occur if there is a hole in the outer layer, but I've also seen tears in the inner layer, and these need to be watched very carefully. We see here two classic examples of retinoschisis in that infratemporal region. This is another classic retinoschisis, this time viewed with the Optomap viewing system. The schisis is in the infratemporal region, and you can see the darker vessels lifting up over that region. And you can also see the different appearance in the red and green channels showing the blood vessels changing. This now is just a table looking at white with pressure and white without pressure. These two things are slightly different, and the table quite nicely shows up the differences. The one point I would make is with white with pressure, it's a very, very common finding within an OptoMap image, and it does look slightly different from the way you will see it in other systems. However, as I say, it is incredibly common finding in people when OptoMap imaging. Now, I'd like to talk about rhegmatogenous retinal detachment. This is detachment of the retina due to a tear. The word comes from the Greek word rhegma, meaning rent or tear. In this detachment, fluid from the vitreous space enters the subretinal space through a break in the actual retina. The effects of such a detachment can vary from slight to catastrophic, depending on the site of the tear. If the tear is in the superior part of the retina can detach fully across the macula in a matter of hours. It is therefore essential to detect these detachments without delay. There are three characteristics to this type of detachment, and these are the presence of liquefied vitreous, some form of tractional force that is responsible for the tear in the retina, and the actual retinal break itself. All three need to be present to cause a rhegmatogenous retinal detachment. If a hole or a tear is present but there is no tractional force or no liquid present, it is unlikely that the retina will detach. However, it is highly important that the patient be seen by a vitreoretinal specialist as a matter of importance. Retinal holes appear as round breaks in the retina. They are atrophic in nature and can sometimes have an associated operculum, this being the piece of retina that's been removed. They can have pigmented margins and, when viewed with autofluorescence, will show as dark areas given the absence of rods or cones. Retinal tears are secondary to dynamic traction between the retina and the vitreous. They're normally irregular in shape and can take various forms, of which a horseshoe tear is possibly one of the most common and most important, as it can indicate that there is still vitreous attachment to the front edge of the tear, and hence further tearing is highly likely. This slide shows an image of a patient who routinely attended for a contact lens aftercare and a short while afterwards decided to have an OptoMap scan as she had noticed a small change in the periphery of her vision, but very few symptoms. As can be seen, I found a large tear in the nasal periphery of her left eye. Due to the time of day, circumstances caused me to drive her myself to the eye unit that was open some 25 miles away, where she was treated that night with laser therapy before being transferred to a larger unit the next day for scleral buccal surgery. As a result, the vision in that eye is still excellent. Now I want to look at lesions that shouldn't give rise to retinal breaks but are common findings in the periphery. So look at snowflake degeneration to start with. This appears as multiple whitish-yellow gleaming dots. They're generally scattered randomly in the periphery. Vitreous liquefaction is a common co-occurrence, and there is a common association with lattice degeneration, snail tract degeneration, and schisis. So whilst not themselves leading to retinal breaks or tears, snowflake is an important finding as it directs the clinician to the presence of other, more risky degenerative changes. Now we look at paving stone and cobblestone degeneration, and these are present in about 25% of normal eyes and are normally found between the oris serrata and the equator. Discrete yellow-white patches of focal chorioretinal atrophy, they are commonly associated with pigmentary changes occurring at the margins of lesions. Often choroidal vessels can be seen more readily through those areas of degeneration. You see an image there. And now we look at peripheral microcystic degeneration, and this is found in the temporal region and is more common with increasing age and often leads to retinoschisis. The appearance is of very small vesicles and whitish background, which give the retina a thickened, less transparent appearance. Often white-walled vessels can be seen running through these areas of degeneration. Possibly one of the most common things that we will see in the older patient is honeycomb degeneration. This is frequently seen over the age of 65. It is caused by degeneration of the retinal pigment epithelium and is most prominent in the nasal quadrants. Hyperfluorescence may well be observed using ultra-wide-field autofluorescent systems, such as the Optos Daytona. And here is a slide of that honeycomb degeneration, and when we see it in the autofluorescent, you can see it much more markedly. Now we look at CHIRPY, congenital hyperplasia of the retinal pigment epithelium. These are congenital and normally occur singly. They're usually black in colour, but can develop lacunae, little lakes which are depigmented areas. Sometimes, in fact, the whole thing can be a lacuna and you have only the black halo left around the edge. Monitoring of these is required. Multiple small CHIRPY can represent bare tracts, and these can be associated with Gardner's syndrome, which could indicate malignant changes in the large intestine. Such multiple lesions require further investigation, whereas single CHIRPYs can just be monitored in practice by the optometrist. We see there a CHIRPY, and we can see very clearly with the Optos image that it appears on both the green channel on the surface and in the deep red channel as well. Diabetic retinopathy in the periphery is so often overlooked, and yet those changes can be precursors to more fundamental changes at the posterior pole. Modern systems that allow views of the periphery should form a fundamental part of any diabetic screening system. Too often, patients are given an all clear from their retinal screening service and yet show marked signs of retinopathy in the periphery. These patients are given annual recalls, and yet there is potential for damage to occur at the central pole long before that year is out. Peripheral drusen. Now, peripheral drusen I've left until the end because it is quite a usual finding in the older patient. Often this type of drusen will be surrounded by pigment rings, and it's common to see larger areas of confluent drusen with hyperpigmented borders. Until recent years, not much attention has been paid to drusen in the periphery. Mainly it's been centred on what's happening around the macular region. But lately, research projects have begun to show a potential link between peripheral drusen and early Alzheimer's disease and dementia. With a readily ageing population, these studies may well point to peripheral retina being a very highly important area for future study and for future regular viewing on this one topic alone. So, how do we manage peripheral retinal degenerations? Most retinal degenerations need to be followed, some closely, with advice being given to patients as to what to look for and what action to take should changes occur. It is fair to say that in the absence of actual retinal breaks, no treatment is likely to be given unless there are associated risk factors. These risk factors include such things as previous detachment in the other eye, where the risk rises to 10% in phakic eyes and 20 to 36% in aphakic eyes. Pseudophakia and YAG capsulotomy patients show a threefold increase in likelihood over phakic patients. This means that if you have patients with pre-existing stable retinal degenerations who go on to have cataract surgery, then post-operatively their risks will increase and closer monitoring may well be required. Highly myopic patients show greater risk, as do patients with a family history of detachments. As mentioned earlier, associated systemic conditions also give rise to higher risk factors. So, in summary, the peripheral retina is a very important area of eye that warrants routine inspection at every examination. There are many changes that can take place. Regular examination of the periphery is now possible with ultra-wide-field devices such as the Optomap Daytona instrument. But even if these are not used, routine dilation and examination of the periphery should be a part of an examination, even in asymptomatic patients. Always remember, prevention is better than cure.